God invited me to go on a cruise this year. I mean, it's just more than I can take. The usher's going to pass out the sign-in tablets. Please take this opportunity to record your attendance. If any of your bio information has changed, please update it so we can better serve your spiritual needs in the coming days and weeks. Our opportunities for the week, the only opportunity this week, the church is open. Church offices are going to be closed most of the week, but we will be having our Christmas Eve candlelight service on tomorrow night at 10:45, night of lights and lessons, carols, and communion. We invite you to come and be a part of that this week. And also, we invite you on next week, New Year's Eve, to join us for our annual New Year's Eve festivities, which include our chili cook-off on that Christmas Eve. It starts at 7 o'clock in Danko Hall. And then at 9 o'clock, we will be having bingo with prizes, and we invite you to come and be a part of that. That's always fun. And then at 11:15, they will gather here in the sanctuary for a time of bringing in the new year of 2013 with communion, a special communion service. And I see that none of you got caught up in the end of the world with the Mayan prediction. A member of the church wrote me a little card and said, "You okay if you're in the city of Birmingham? Because everything gets to Birmingham 10 years later." So I'm so glad that you're here. Amen. I want to remind you that there will be no leadership class, obviously, this week. And also remind you that the Inquirers class will be January the 12th, and also the praise dance. And we want to thank God for our Wings of Worship and the praise dance. And they're going to, if you have anyone that's interested, there's a number there to call Latricia Barron with. Also, we want to thank God for Shirley Cooper's friend Brenda's test showed no cancer, that she's cancer-free. And Linda Green, which is Susan Green's mother, has been very ill, but she's better and she's improving, and we're so grateful. Amen? Our board member on duty today is Will Johnson, and the assistant board member is, what's your name again? No, it's Bobby Cousin. Keep Cynthia in prayer. Cynthia had surgery. It's supposed to be Cynthia. She had surgery on Friday, and she thought she'd be up and about, and I told her when I was at the hospital, but that ain't going to happen. But she does have good drugs, so don't worry about that, okay? And our board member on duty is Mother Battles, and if you have any questions, any needs, please see one of them. They'll be glad to help you in any way they can. Birthdays, no children's church today, and birthdays today, Sissy's birthday is today. We should all beat him. We don't reward bad behavior, though. John Lynch's birthday is on the 24th, and Alicia Griffin's birthday is the 26th. Let's wish them all happy birthday. They may still have a cupcake from last week if you need it, okay? We want to thank Mary Jones for preparing last Wednesday night's family night supper. And we want to thank all the PowerPoint team. It's now the Media Shout team. Tammy and all the volunteers for your constant dedication. We thank you for that. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. The peace of the Lord be with you. Let us rise and greet one another in peace. Thank you.
Please rise in spirit and stand as you're able for the singing of our processional hymn, Angels We Have Heard on High.
Lit the candle of hope to pierce through the darkness of despair. We then lit the candle of peace that lets in God's deep and tranquil spirit. Last week, we lit the candle of joy that sustains us during troubled times. Today, we light the candle of love, for no other word so adequately captures the spirit of our faith this Advent season than love. On this fourth Sunday of Advent, we celebrate the love of God as Emmanuel, God with us, as we light the candles of hope peace, joy, and love.
Sing our praise chorus, O come, let us adore him.
Most Wednesday nights, there's a group of us that meet in the pastor's study at 6:30 on Wednesday. By then, Jamie, our prayer minister, will have prepared a list of all the prayer requests that we've received, not just these, but those that come over the internet, telephone, however we get them. And then on that night, we lift them individually before the throne of grace. I often say, my mom used to say, I wouldn't serve a God who didn't heal sometime or answer prayer sometime. I believe in a God who answers prayer. And so we gather and we pray over them and we take the list with us and then we pray over them the rest of the week. This is a wonderful time of the year. Lots of joy and all those things are going on. But some people's hearts are heavy. Some people have all kinds of things that they're faced with. And we need to pause and remember them in prayer today. Perhaps you're one of them. Maybe you didn't make your request known, but you have an unspoken prayer. And you'd like for us to remember this week, which is so signified by the raising of your hand. Let us go to God in prayer. Loving God, we do thank you for this day as we approach the remembrance day of your son's birth. We come to adore you, for you alone are worthy. And in our worship and our praise of you, Lord, we also lift the prayer requests and the praise reports of these your people. And we gather from the world on these 2 days before Christmas, and we remember how so many of our people are traveling and they need your divine mercy. We remember that so many people, God, are going through difficult times during the seasons. They've lost someone this year, someone special. We especially remember those families in Connecticut. And God, we come to you right now and we ask that you would be with us, that you would pour out your love and your spirit on us, that we might know that we know that we know that the real thing at Christmas is your love. And so God, as we gather from the world today, we know that you've heard every known prayer request and also those unspoken. And yet, God, we still lift them up to you, because we still believe you're able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think. And so, God, we just gather and we ask that you would be with the people of this congregation, that you would be with those that are troubled in body and spirit. You would be with the concerns of our community and the world and its leaders and your church. In Jesus' name, and all God's children said, let's worship the Lord this morning. Oh, come.
Oh, come, let us adore him.
Oh, come.
Oh, come, let us adore him.
Oh, come, let us adore him.
Oh, come, let us adore him.
Sunday of Advent, the Sunday of Love, is from Romans, the 16th chapter, the 25th through the 27th verse. Now to him who is able to establish in you, in accordance with the gospel, the message I proclaim about Jesus Christ, in keeping with the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God, so that all the Gentiles may come to the obedience that comes from faith. In the only wise, God be glorified forever through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please rise in spirit and stand as you are able, for the good news is from the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Christmas chorus, but let's worship the Lord this morning. Let's think about his love. Think about his love.
Think about his love. Think about his goodness. Think about His grace that brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love.
You know this chorus, sing it with us. Think about His love. His goodness.
Think about His goodness.
Don't forget about that grace.
Think about His grace.
Because praise God, that's what brought us through.
For
as high as the heavens above,
for as high as the heavens above,
so great. So great is the measure of our Father's
that there are very few songs that would be a Christmas song and an Easter song. But that chorus, Think About His Love, that's a Christmas song and an Easter song. Amen? There's never a bad time to think about His love, to think about His goodness, and to think about His grace. Thank you, choir. We thank you on this Love Sunday for that. Today's theme, of course, is love. As we enter this final stretch, last 2 days before Christmas, the malls, I mean, we were talking in the office, but we come out, I guess I was talking to Shelly and Susan, they were talking about no parking spaces, even out in Alabaster and places like that. And I'm thinking, what are you doing out in Alabaster? But I didn't say that. But anyway, the malls, the internet. Every shopping venue is filled to capacity with people trying to find that special gift or that special somebody. It's just so sweet. That just says, I love you. Really. You know what? Unfortunately, too many of us think that you can say, I love you with things. And you can't. Many of us are always searching, trying to find that real thing, love. And yet, love seems to be so elusive. We look for it in the perfect person. We look for it in the perfect relationship, and there ain't no such thing. So if you want to find the real thing, I suggest you start with God's love for you. That's the real thing. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that you and you, or maybe, yeah, you and you and you and you might come to know and accept that love and have eternal life. And so on this fourth Sunday of Advent, Love Sunday, I want to briefly share with you about love and finding the real thing at Christmas. Let us pray. God, you really are awesome in this place. Because every time we think about your love and think about your grace, think about your goodness and your mercy, it becomes awesome to us. And so God, help us to think about it one more time right now. Let these lips of mine, these lips of clay, speak your word with such confidence that these, your people, may hear and understand and receive with gladness your word for them this day. For we pray it in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen and amen. Love. Finding the real thing at Christmas. A friend of mine from Atlanta called me and wanted me to try to find tickets to the Justin Bieber concert that's coming up in January here for her daughter. Evidently, that's the rage. And so I was trying to find them, and they start at $100 a piece, the cheap seat. Why would somebody pay $100 to see a 16-year-old? I mean, give me a break. And so I really don't know anything about Justin Bieber. And so I thought I would just try to find out why this kid is so popular. And so I went to YouTube. You know, that's my source of information on this. And so I pulled him out, and he had a Christmas song called, what was it, Christmas Love. And here's this little high-pitched voice going, baby, I will not pout. Baby, I will not cry, because I have your love at Christmas time. When snow's on the ground and it's freezing outside, I got your love this Christmas time. I thought, $100 for that? And besides that, I heard that he and Selena Gomez broke up, so he ain't gonna have her love this Christmas time. After my comments last Sunday about country music, I figure I need to redeem myself a little. So here we go. I think what Justin Bieber needs to do, I think he needs to start singing country songs. That's what I think. I think maybe this year he needs to sing that old Christmas song, I was looking for love in all the wrong places, looking for love in too many faces, searching for eyes, looking for traces of what I'm dreaming of, hoping to find a friend and a lover. God bless the day I discover another heart looking for love. I think that's the song he needs to be singing this Christmas, if I'm going to pay him $100 anyway. But you know, there's some wisdom in those words. Did you hear that last line? God bless the day I discover another heart looking for love. That's what happened at Christmas. God's heart was looking for your love. And he came to give your love. The whole Christmas story is that the heart of God loves you so much that he came in the flesh that first Christmas as Emmanuel. The gospel reading today was supposed to be lectionary gospel, Luke, the first chapter. You know, Mary, talking, you know, that whole story about Mary. And I thought, no, we ain't gonna do that. We'll do that on Christmas Eve. Let's go to the heart of the matter. John 3:16. Because that's the real story of Christmas. Oh, you don't have no angels, you don't have no shepherds and nothing. But that's the real heart of the story. If you want to find the real thing at Christmas, go to John 3:16. And so on this Love Sunday, I just want to share with you very quickly. We're going to get you out here quick today. Nobody said amen. They may want to stay. Maybe I'll add a little to the sermon, Joe, and keep you a little while long. I know where you live. You just live four houses up from me. Three very quick things about God's heart while you're looking for love. The first thing is this. If you're looking for love, you'll find the real thing, which is God's love, it comes in unexpected ways. It seems to never come the way you expect it. Most people love to daydream about how they will find the love that will last a lifetime. And most of us, let's be honest, are not realistic in our daydreaming. But somehow, when we have daydreamed about something being that way, it becomes the reality for us. And then when it doesn't happen that way for us, we often then miss love when it do come. And that's also true of the real thing, God's love. That's what the story of Christmas is about in the gospel. In both Luke and John's account, it's about how God's love comes in unusual ways. Love comes in unexpected ways. And even now, sometimes we miss it. You know, from the Luke 1 thing, the visit and the message of the angels dazzle us. The frightened young obedient girl from Palestine moves us. A faithful and loving fiance inspires us. The virgin birth challenges our mind and stretches our faith. But the fact of the matter is, none of that is the central character. None of those people are the central characters of that story. The central character is God. For God so loved the world that he gave his son. And this is a story about finding the real thing at Christmas, God's love, which will come to you in the most unexpected way. John's account of the story is so matter of fact. It begins not in John 3, it begins at the very first verse of John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then in the 14th verse, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's the Christmas story. And then you hear behind it the whole meaning of the story in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Why? Just to demonstrate that first Christmas, real love. And it came wrapped in flesh and blood and laid in a manger. And regardless of whether you're reading the Luke story or the John story, both tell you about the real thing at Christmas, God's love. And I hope this year you're going to find love in your life. I'm not going home for Christmas this year. The last of the old girls died August the 30th. But I'm going to spend Christmas with Savior. And I'm just going to love on that little boy. He's had a rough year. And we're just going to love on him, and I'm going to spoil him. Then I'm going to leave him for his mama to handle. So I hope you find something, one you can just love on this year. I hope that you have it in your family as well as your significant other if you're so blessed. I hope if you don't, you have it in your friends, in your family of choice like you're at Covenant. But if you don't have it, there's still a way to find it. It starts with expecting it in unexpected ways. That love that came in the world with that Christ child. Hear me clearly today. The gospel story is about how much God loves you and how much that first Christmas that God was willing to go through just to bring that message face to face for you. You may be looking at the story 2,000 years in arrears, but it's a story that's very real for you right now, that no matter what you're going through, nothing in this world can separate you from God's love. That's why that song was so important this morning. Think about His love. No matter what you're faced with, you think about His love because that's the real thing at Christmas. Amen? Finding the real thing at Christmas means finally understanding God's love and realizing it comes in so many unexpected ways. The second thing, if you're looking for love, finding the real thing at Christmas means that God's love is a really wonderful gift. But you don't have to do anything to get it other than accept it. Accept it. What do I mean? I mean this gift is for every last one of us. It's for me on my best day and my worst day. It's for me when I'm Pastor J.R. and it's also for me when I'm little hellion J.R. Not as much as some of y'all, but you know, that's another story. The real thing is unconditional. Around here, I like to say, come and experience the unconditional love of God without the guilt of religion. Why do we say that? Why do I say that so often and in so many different ways and try to create new ways to say it? It's because so many of us need to lie ourselves. By that I mean we need to get rid of this lie that somehow got instilled in us that God don't love us. That God loves other people, but for some reason you're beyond the bounds of God's love. That somehow you got to work and work. You got to give up being who you are. You got to do all this kind of stuff just to experience God's love. Most churches teach that God's love and grace is free, but they don't believe it. And if they believe it, they certainly are not practicing it. Because in many churches, they attach all of these qualifiers, if and but, about God's love. And you've heard what I've said about that before. Some wise person said, if and buts was candy and nuts, we'd all have a Merry Christmas. But some churches have these lists of what you have to do if you're going to experience God's love. And they make it impossible for us to ever be comfortable feeling that we can ever find or experience the real thing of God's love, especially after Christmas. That's why there's such depression in our community around Christmas. The God who came 2,000 years ago don't love me. But I've come to tell you today, you don't have to do anything to achieve God's love. You don't have to work at it. There are no certain ways to find the real thing at Christmas. All you got to do is just accept it. It's there. He didn't attach anything with it except you open your heart and receive it. And it's a gift that takes a lifetime to unwrap. Amen? Far too many people in our community have never taken the bow off of God's love in their life. The package is still under the tree of their life. And so they've never really found the real thing. And as you prepare for these last days of Christmas, I pray that you will take the time and all this hustle and bustle of Christmas to accept the gift of Jesus Christ into your life. Find the real thing this Christmas, God's love. And all you have to do is just accept it. You don't have to go to the mall and get it. You don't even have to leave your house and get it. All you have to do is open your heart and simply receive. There's a third thing. If we find the real thing at Christmas, God's love, it means that it changes everything. God wants to change your life. God is not interested in changing your sexual orientation or any of that kind of stuff that people preach. God wants to change your life. Do you know why he wants to change your life? He also says it in John 10:10. I come that you might have life and have it abundantly. God knows that if you accept God's love, you take the bow off of God's love and begin to live it, it'll change your life. It'll change your life. Where there was once depression, you will have joy. Where there was once hopelessness, you will find hope in your life. God wants to give you that gift so that it changes everything. You see, the moment that Jesus Christ enters into our hearts, he enters into our loneliness, he enters into our pain, he enters into our anguish, and he enters into our difficulties, and he brings God's love and care, and he tells us, weeping might endure for the night, but joy is coming in the morning. That's the real thing of Christmas. And if we can receive it, if we can grasp it, God's love will make our life so much more enjoyable because it gives us hope. And that's what God offers us this Christmas. In the manger at that first Christmas, the shepherds found that gift all wrapped up, not with a ribbon and bow, but in salvation, grace, new life, forgiveness, hope, and redemption that was embodied in that Christ child that lay in that manger. Because at that moment, time had intersected with eternity, and God had became a human, and Emmanuel became God with us. Amen? That's the message of Christmas. I pray that that's what we try to tell other people, those special people in our lives, with our gifts. I pray that if you give someone a gift this year, it says to them, you matter to me. It's not the right thing to do. I'm giving it because you matter to me. I love you. And of all the things there are in this world, nothing is as important as you are. That's what it means, finding the real thing at Christmas, God's love. It means that we can say to each other, only because that loving God said it to us first. The epistle lesson this morning, the last words of Romans 16, the last chapter. It's a benediction, actually. But it sort of points to the finding the real thing, God's love in Christ, this Advent season. It says, now unto him who is able to establish you by my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known to the only wise God, be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen. Do you know that the mystery that was hidden for so long, but now revealed, came on that first Christmas? It was Jesus And what it really meant was, this is the very extent that God would go through just to let you know how much he loved you. We find Paul saying it in a different place. You know, Paul's account of the Christmas story is the second chapter of Philippians, where he says that he took no thought of setting aside his only his kingdom. And he humbled himself and came in human flesh as we are. Why did God do that? I wouldn't have done it. But it was just to tell you how much he loved you. The good news for us today, that in 2012, we can still find the real thing. So many people are still trying to find the real thing this Christmas, and they can't seem to find it. I hope you're not one of them. But if you are, maybe, just maybe, it's because you haven't, maybe you left the package of God's love unclaimed in your life. And so if you have, if that's happened to you, why don't you just open up the package today? Why don't you claim on this fourth Sunday of Advent, Love Sunday, that gift from God, and tear that bow off and release that love in your life? Or maybe you accepted that gift of love at one time in your life, and you've been carrying it around, but you failed to unwrap it. And so you're still walking around believing God doesn't love you. Why don't you unwrap the thing? The gift of God's unconditional love in your life. And believe that for me, whatever my situation is today, it is a gift that is able to change everything. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the throne of God, to the only wise God, be glory and honor forever. The package is all alike. It doesn't change. Yours and mine is just like that. And this is what it says. It simply says, I love you. I love you with an everlasting love. I love you without conditions. I love you so much that I came, I gave up my kingdom to come down and tell you as Emmanuel, God with you, that I love you. And it's all got the same name tag on it, signed, God, Emmanuel. If you've been looking for love in all the wrong places, to the right place today. If you're looking for love, the real thing at Christmas, you're not going to find it shopping. You're not going to find it partying. Ain't nothing wrong with a good party at the right pub. But you find it in Emmanuel. Long time ago, someone coined the phrase, wise men and women still seek. I wonder if that applies to you today. As we sing this little chorus this morning, it's a brief little chorus, I invite you to open your heart right where you are. If you already know Jesus as your Savior, I'm asking you to open your heart and accept His love. Let it become so real in your life that nobody can steal your joy this Christmas. None of the circumstances of your life can take that joy away from you. Just let Emmanuel be with you. God with us, reveal it. Unwrap it. Take off the bow of God's love and find what God really wants to be like in your life this Christmas. Stand and sing.
God with us. treasurer's office, I would just like to remind everyone that there's 2 weeks left in the year. And if you'd like to get your last minute tax donation, this Sunday is a wonderful Sunday to do that. But seriously, this is Love Sunday. And I cannot think of a better way to give back to God. We've heard all about it this morning, about his love. And even the scripture tells us, for God so loved the world that he did what? He gave. So what better gift for us to give Jesus on this Sunday before Christmas than to give from our hearts so that we can further the ministries of this church? Would the ushers please come forward? And for your mercy. And most of all, God, we thank you for your love, the amazing gift of love. Lord, we ask that you bless each gift and each giver so that we can continue to serve you throughout the new year. All this we ask in your holy name. Amen.
You said you would supply.
fourth Sunday of Advent, let us prepare ourselves for the receiving of the sacrament of Holy Communion as we say together our general confession. Let us pray. God of love, we confess our need for love, the real thing at Christmas. Forgive us for our sins and empower us to experience Emmanuel, God with us, this holiday season. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. We now pause for a moment to individually confess to you, Almighty God, all those things that have separated us from you and others and even our best selves. Join together the prayer that Jesus taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hear now our words of assurance. God's forgiveness, as always with God's love, is the real thing at Christmas and at every day. And therefore, brothers and sisters, on this day, 2 days before Christmas, I want you to hear me very clearly. I want you to know that God has heard your confession. And beloved, you are forgive. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen. Would you please join me in the liturgy of the Great Thanksgiving? God be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to God. It is a right, a good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Creator God. Therefore, we join our voices with the angels and the archangels and all of the company and hosts of heaven, proclaiming your glory. Sing.
So
stretch forth your hands as we collectively, as the body of Christ, consecrate these elements. Eternal and present God, we pray that you send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the real thing for us this Christmas, of your body and your blood, which is your love. For we pray it in Jesus' name, and all God's children said, amen. Amen. Let us join together proclaiming the affirmation of the mystery of our faith. This table has been set by the hand of the people who prepared the altar, but the meal was prepared by God. And it's the real thing this Christmas. It is God's love. Why don't you come and taste and see how God is? This is a special time for someone that may be meeting and unwrapping the present of God's love for the first time, or the first time in a long time. Let's be mindful of those around us in reverence. If you need special prayer, there will be an intercessor at the altar immediately following the service who will gladly pray with you. But right now, come taste and see how good God's love really is as the ushers do it.